And then we now recite the confiti here together. I confess to Almighty God, Lord of the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those as well within the Church of Christ, Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Angels, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as leading my brothers and sisters to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And
Lord, hear our prayer.
And
then
I cry unto you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments, and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to the people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, and you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your Son has taught us that all that we possess and we have in trust are from you. Help us be faithful in our stewardship, that in earning we may be just, and in spending honorable, that we not seek our own indulgence, but rather your glory and the good of others. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our most merciful Father, on this day we commemorate your prayer, new dedication of our church's fraternal. We ask your blessing upon her leaders and members, and that you would grant eternal happiness and peace to those who were her organizers in 1908, and to those members who, in the protection of your providence, have passed from this life. May our fraternal organization stand ever ready to fulfill her goals of fraternal service and supporting the church in her mission to lead people to you. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Amos. Alas, for those who are at ease in Zion, and for those who feel secure on Mount Samariah, the notables of the first of the nations to whom the house of Israel resorts. Alas, for those who lie in beds of ivory and lounge on their couches and eat lambs from the flock and calves from the stall, who sing idle songs to the sound of the harp, and like David, improvise on instruments of music, who drink wine from bowls and anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore, they shall now be the first to go into exile, and the revelry of the loungers shall pass away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed are those whose help is Jacob's God, whose hope is in the Lord their God. Alleluia, alleluia. He who shuts his ear to the cry of the poor will himself also call and not be heard. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. And Jesus said, there was a rich man who dressed in purple garments and fine linen and dined sumptuously each day. But lying at his door was a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who would have gladly eaten the fill of the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. Dogs even used to come and lick his sores. When the poor man died, he was carried away by the angel to the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also died, he was buried. And from the netherworld, where he was in torment, he raised his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus at his side. And he cried out, Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am suffering torment in these flames. And Abraham replied, my child, remember that you received what was good during your lifetime, while Lazarus likewise received what was bad. But now he is comforted here, whereas you are tormented. Moreover, between us and you, a great chasm is established to prevent anyone from crossing who might wish to go from one side to the other. And he said, then I beg you, Father, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that they may also learn from this lesson of mine. But Abraham replied, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. He said, oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, then surely they will repent. And Abraham said, if they will not listen to Moses and to the prophets, neither will they be persuaded even if someone should rise from the dead. For this is the gospel of the Lord. Means that we're only 3 months away from Christmas. We all know what that means.
Christmas decorations and Christmas sales are just around the corner. Halloween candy has been on the store shelf since the hottest days of summer. I have no idea who goes out to buy Halloween candy in August or why, but before those Halloween decorations are even off the shelves, here comes Christmas already. I can't speak for anyone else, but by the time I hear that song, at least Navidad, like around the 70th day, I can barely stand it. I still love my Bethlehem Christmas, but one more chorus of 21 times where he says Feliz Navidad to me, and I tell my brain could just explode all over the place. Too much and unnecessary preparation can actually diminish the excitement of what we're preparing for. In other words, it can actually backfire. And the same thing applies to church. Church is not only about dying and what happens after death. Church is about here and now. But too many people think the only time you need church is when things are a little bit scary. Now, let's go back to today's gospel. The rich man of Lazarus is another one of Jesus' parables. And it is no more based on fact than, say, the parable of the Good Samaritan, the parable of the prodigal son. The purpose of the parables is to teach, and we're not talking history, we're talking teaching. The Good Samaritan teaches about brotherly love, the prodigal son teaches about a loving God, and the lessons are real even though the events are not. Last Sunday I told you the joke about God's email to 5% of the people who are still good and faithful down here on earth. The purpose of that story is to reinforce the message that the good and the faithful have always been the minority down here on earth, and that there have always been too many people around who have no conscience whatsoever. They'd steal the last coin out of a blind man's cup. And that the story was made up has no effect at all on the teaching behind the story. Jesus was an expert storyteller. Some Bible scholars actually say that no other Bible author dares to use parable as their main source of story, or their main office of teaching, because it was so closely associated with Jesus. It was a distinctive way in which he spoke and he taught. And today's selection about the rich man and Lazarus is a beautiful example of Jesus as a storyteller. The rich man and Lazarus does not reveal some hidden mystery about the afterlife. I guarantee, I promise you, that heaven is not about people on one side in flames, some kind of impassable chasm, and then people over here just sitting around lounging in heaven. That's not the purpose of the parable. It's not to tell us what heaven looks like. It's to teach us a message. So the imagery of being held in the bosom of Abraham, the torment of flames that do not consume, and that unpassable chasm, that is not the purpose of the story. And it's no more the revealing some kind of historical fact than last Sunday we had the parable of the dishonest steward. That didn't actually have to happen for the message to be learned. So we don't want to get caught up in the details of the story like we're only talking about heaven, because Jesus in this parable is not talking about heaven. The rich man and Lazarus uses the imagery of heaven not to teach about some afterlife, but about right here and right now. Heaven is real, and I'm sure it is absolutely wonderful, but Jesus leaves heaven for heaven. You know, after Jesus dies, after Jesus resurrects, he comes back and he spends time on earth, and you know, he says not one word about what heaven was like. It's just not the way he's orientated. Heaven is for a later time, and we'll find out when we get there, but what Jesus is concerned about is what we do here and now to someday get to heaven. And when we get there, we'll find out what heaven is like. And I bet you it's better than our fondest imaginations, but it's not about flames and chasms and sitting in the bosom of Abraham. But Jesus isn't going to turn heaven into a Feliz Navidad type of Christmas. Jesus' message doesn't concentrate on the afterlife for our whole human life. So that day after day, the message of the church is, what about heaven? It concentrates on this life, because this life is important, and it can't be simply passed over in church as we wait to get to heaven. And that's where we look, for the meaning and the purpose of this morning's parable. We don't want to become so preoccupied with what happens at the end of life that we miss the beauty and the purpose of this life. Jesus' story begins with a picture of a terrible disparity of wealth, but that's only a backdrop for a picture of an even more terrible disregard for the plight of others. When you heard Jesus' story, you may have thought to yourself,
how can anyone possibly enjoy themselves in heaven if they have to look across this chasm and look at all these other people who are burning forever in flames? Now, Lazarus' situation is bad, but it's a lifetime. So if you take that message and then say that a loving God throws somebody into hell and they go through worse torment than Lazarus, not for a lifetime, not for 10 lifetimes, not for 100 lifetimes, but forever, that really doesn't fit in too well with the message of caring for others and a loving God. So I don't think that's what Jesus is talking about. I don't think watching people in flames is in too many people's picture of what paradise entails. But Jesus does this on purpose. It highlights the complete disregard of the rich man when Lazarus lay at that gate of his in hunger and pain, and the rich man simply could not have cared any less. It's not a story about heaven. If it were, Lazarus would be of the same temperament as the rich man, completely unconcerned, and therefore completely unworthy of heaven. It's a story about this life and the consequences of being so self-absorbed that those in need become invisible to us. And it's also a story about a blindness to God and the things of God. The rich man is not without some redeeming characteristics. He worries about his family, and he tries to warn them before it is too late for them. And so he begs that Lazarus be sent back to earth to warn them. And this is where the parable ties into the association of Lazarus with the one that Jesus has raised from the dead. And Abraham says, if they do not listen to Moses, if they do not listen to the prophets, neither will they be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. Those people watched Lazarus come out of the grave. And how many of those people actually believed in Jesus? He goes to the cross, and he's almost all alone. Where were those people who saw the miracles? Where are those people who saw Lazarus come out of the grave after Easter? Where were those people who witnessed the resurrection? The group was small. You're not going to be forced into believing by a miracle. You have to want to believe. You have to be touched in the heart by the teachings of Jesus. And that's that ironic twinge of the parable. Moses, the prophets, Lazarus, even a resurrected Jesus are all testimonies that life is more than this world, and that if we're really, really excited about the thought of heaven, then we don't need countless reminders as if 3 months worth of getting ready for Christmas is going to make Christmas even better. We don't need constant reminders about heaven. We need to have more conviction now before we even think about heaven. And according to Jesus' parable today, a lot of that heavenly worthiness has to do not only with coming to church, but what we do for each other. The rich man's blindness to Lazarus was an offense not only against the man, but says Jesus, was an offense against God. Think about this as we approach the crowd hunger walk. This is not only charity. This is an act of righteousness. Think about the story of our church's fraternal that we celebrate today. It was organized to help the people of our church in real and tangible ways. The church is there to help and heal the soul, but we're not ignoring the fact that we're also called upon to care for each other too, to come together and help us all be raised up a little bit. Let us pray for those who are blind to the plight of others, that somehow they may see. And let us also pray that we may count both our presence here and whatever we do for our neighbors, especially those in need, as part of our worship. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this beautiful fall Sunday morning, we offer prayers for Eddie Santos for a speedy recovery. It's offered by Linda Pahalski. We offer prayers for my goddaughter and niece, Amanda, who lost her baby in a miscarriage. It's offered by Bridget Lawrence. We offer prayers for Liz Richmond, recently diagnosed with cancer, raising 3 young girls on her own. It's offered by Cindy Benchin. We continue to offer prayers as well for those battling cancer. Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Strosky. Brandy Clemens by grandmother Dottie Baronis. Carl Dickinson by Joe and Peg Kostjum. Fathers Ray Dreda, Jan Bielczyk, and Maurice Lazelle is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. And 2-year-old Jack Sela is offered by Marianna Foster. Frank Skrosky by his twin brother Don, Skrosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. And Peg, I know we've got an intention here, but I can't make out Earl's last name.
McGraw.
Also, for the soul of Earl McGraw, who lost his battle with cancer, is offered by Peg Kostya. Are there any other intentions that you would like to offer from the congregation?
One for Josephine from the ANS.
Very nice. Josephine Lisensky, I anointed her a week ago Friday. I thought I saw her for the last time this past Sunday, 1 week ago. I talked to Joe Lisensky, and on Friday they moved her out of the hospital into Linda Manor. She's eating again, soft foods and everything else. She's not in great shape, but she looks a lot better than she did 1 week ago. So we'll keep Josephine Lisensky in our prayers as well. And yet, yes?
For Jenny Matos.
Jenny Matos?
Matos.
Matos, okay, for a stroke last night.
For the continued help of my son-in-law, Ray Lindahl.
Sure.
And open heart surgery.
Yeah, and things are going well. He's back home in Hatfield, and his wife and his son are right there. Yeah, I see Ben. Yeah, Ben's all happy. Okay.
Also, update, Father, on little Jack. His chemotherapy has failed, and the only thing that they can do now is a liver transplant. Pray that some people find a donor for his liver transplant.
All right. Sorry to hear that. Any other intentions you'd like to offer? For all of these intentions, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before you at this time, plus, Lord, we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and of course, those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass
against us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest, friends, unto him, O Lord. May he rest in peace. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. Came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and Giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray.
To do what is right and just is more acceptable to the Lord than any sacrifice offered. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust within the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, who They said to them, I myself, the living bread, come down from heaven. Anyone eats this bread should live forever. Bread I give is my flesh, the life of the world. Lord God, you give me great dignity and worthy. Jesus Christ, you saw me for you and thank you.
Remember, Lord, your servant.
congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love. Wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those, beginning the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father to give you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst." And after these and other words of the archpriest's prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of this, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this in remembrance of me." Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of eternal salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, O Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son, who is all, may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us in the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life stray from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings, we ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Numbers in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence. Sacrament, through your loving kindness, may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master awakened me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it last and I mean entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives and reigns with God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return unto the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord to be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to see you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
The body and the blood of Christ.
Injure not the poor because they are poor, nor crush the needy at the gate. For the Lord will defend their cause and will plunder the lives of those who plunder them. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Compassionate Lord Jesus, give us who have now received your word and also your body and blood the grace to see you in all who are poor and to always be ready to love and serve them for your sake. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Let us pray. Gracious God, through whose goodness the gifts of love and brotherhood are continually poured upon your faithful people, we ask you to bless the membership of our church's fraternal and order them through this organization. They may continue in their labor for the good of your church, our nation, and all people. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered. May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, am offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found light, light from the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing it, but by God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.